Do you like electronics? Oh, that sounded awful. Sorry, MatPat. Anyway, I built this shelf. No, no, not that kind of shelf, this shelf. Using all loads of spare parts, and the main ingredient is an ATmega328P. P or not to P, that is the question. Before I show that, I'd like to show this other board I have. It's a Cypress CY7C680138A. It's a pretty nifty little board with a high-speed USB, but it doesn't have a built-in ADC. And an annoying little thing is some of the pins are swapped around, especially this ground pin here is swapped for plus 3 volts. I have a top tip for you. If you do have one of these boards and an old IDE cable, especially the old style like the 33 meg, you can chop it right down the centre and it just fits perfectly on both of the headers. It's ideal. Here's an example of like a resistor divider. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 levels. That's about 3 bits, which is going to plug onto one of the 8-bit ports. Well, 3-bit ADC. It's a CMOS input, and the sweet spot for it flipping from off and on was 1.51 volts. As you can see there, on is 156 and off is 147. It kind of floats in between there. And trying to find out a nice even divider all the way between 0 to 3.3 volts, so you can see where the resistors are used. That was a bit of a pain in the arse. But of course, first we'd have to start with the middle one. The next one above is 135 volts, so well, it's not too hard just to quickly scroll through them or do things by halves. As you can see on this little LT Spice diagram, it shows the different levels of the voltages. I also ran through it again, but using slightly different voltage values, so you get those between points quite well, as you'll probably notice in the middle. I just ran them again, and yeah. I also tried the Delta Sigma approach, but that was just a no start. I was also trying a different technique, which might look a bit more familiar. I create a digital to analog converter in order to create the analog to digital converter. For example, at the bottom, you could see a classic resistor ladder. And then you got the input on the left. And then it goes through an op amp. The only problem is it's slow, because I've only got very generic op amps. They're just useless at high volts, as in 5 volts is high volts. So it can only swing about half a volt per microsecond, which really isn't very good. I mean, here you can just see some little mini simulations. They look pretty good, but it's just no good at high frequencies. And here's the AVR I used. It cost about £1.50, it's about $2. It's not bad, because I was searching around and this one actually has a serial to USB already on it. I thought, that is a sight perfect. It's one of those new Chinese ones, I think, due to FDI gate. It's the CH340G. And the data sheet says it can handle up to 2 megaboards, so that's not bad. Well, running at 16 meg, I can pump through 1 megaboard, which seems to work quite well. But there was a problem with it. This resistor here was completely open circuit. It looks absolutely fine. Because it's the first time I ever used that chip, I didn't know what I was doing wrong. I don't know if it was a driver problem or a programmer problem. You know, I had to literally connect up a serial program, as in like the SPI port, to figure out that resistor was at fault. All the lights were flashing and everything, but oh well. That was a wasted day. At least I got a copy of the bootloader, just in case. I was going to use this switch here. Unfortunately, it's just a single pole, which is causing really problems, but luckily I found this. This switch is almost perfect. It's a 4-way 3-pole switch, and it would be ideal for what I need. Unfortunately, I think a 4-way 4-pole would be better, but I can't argue. Also did a VGA attempt here. It's probably the best I could do, so it worked, but fortunately, that with all the ADC running in the background, that just won't work very long. Also, I've got an old alarm clock front panel. Don't know where I saved it from, but that could be ideal for displaying some numbers. Thing is, though, I needed some serial to parallel shift registers. Luckily, what I did have is some octal flip-flops, so I just started to stick them together, and you can see the row of resistors, they're all 1Ks. I should have used half of that, but I just didn't have that many. And I actually ran out of the small 1Ks, so I had to move on to the large ones. And you can see the mess that I've made trying to solder it together. I crammed it in such a small space. Heck, it just about works. Managed to get 32 data pins down to just 2. If I clock one in, zero it round, looks pretty nifty. clock in loads of ones and loads of zeros. And then I mapped each one out onto here so I could see what I was doing. This looks pretty nifty. Now if I could feed some numbers in. Bing! I'll do it again because it just looks pretty cool. Seems to rotate around and snap in. Just using some very basic code. Ooh. Here are some old buttons with about 100 ohm contact resistance. It's a bit high, but that should work okay. I'll make a resistor divider so I can sort of effectively put those 8 buttons into one analog port. But after a little test, I didn't realise that if you set the multimeter to like 100 ohm range, it seems to show 50 ohms. Set to the kilo ohm range, and it seems to show about 2 or 3 kilo ohms in connectivity. That's useless. So luckily I found some other buttons here. One thing was a little nifty, it had some IDE connectors here which seemed to fit perfectly on their headers of the 80 mega mini board. So luckily I can reuse it again if I need to, or a bit of maintenance. First test using a 4.7 volt reference. Alright, shove that on there. No, try again. There you go, 1.2 volts, that battery is really dead. And if I test it on this one. No, try that again. There you go, 3.7 volts. That's not bad. These are the crazy formulas used for a resistor divider in order to create attenuation and voltage offset. So I'm able to put in negative volts into the ADC. Unfortunately, it does require a low impedance input. Over here, I added a 96k resistor going in, a 15k up to ground, and about an 18k going to positive. And so, in general, this accepts, this quick test accepts about 30 volts, as in 30 volts plus and 30 volts minus. When nothing's connected input, it just the value floats high. I short it down to ground. It just reads a little high, but it still works. If I connect a battery. Oh, one-handed, I can do this. I think, there you go, 3.8 volts. I'll flip it round. Oh, balance. Minus about 3.7. That's not bad for like an uncalibrated test. This is the original box I had. It had lots of holes because I had it for something else. I thought, that'd be perfect. Unfortunately, it's just not big enough to fit all the stuff in. So, luckily I've got this old like TV tuner, or digital TV tuner. That box is nice and big, that'd be perfect. Here's the main part of the circuit. You can see the input comes in from the left. At the moment it's a test signs wave, goes through the switch, effectively through the resistor dividers and into the ADC. I set it at 4 ranges. I know the fourth one is set to 360 volts, so there's no way I'm planning on using it at that, but it's just in case I touch it at rectified mains, it should last for a couple of seconds. And then you can also see I've just duplicated for channels 3, 4 and 2, just at fixed at 30 volts, because that'll do for me. Thanks to TI, they've created an Excel spreadsheet which works it all out for you. It's brilliant. Just set the input impedance, and you see all the voltages around there, and it calculates the two middle resistors. But for the output, you have to make sure it's below 10k impedance. And even for some of the older Atmels, you need to be as low as 2k impedance. And here's me putting it all together. You can sort of see the progress I've made. Here you can see I run out of buttons, so I had to resort to switches, which is a bit of a pain in the ass. Check out how many resistors are in this thing. Thank you. 82 resistors. Here's the bird's nest with everything connected. Luckily, the older ATmega board just fits perfectly where the screw join is. So when it's in, it doesn't actually only rattles very, very slightly. Still got a bit of slack, but stays in place. And a nice overview shot. To be honest, I think it would have been better for me to use some black indelible pen than trying to stick little notes all over the place. I'm using just 6 out of 8 pins to make the waveform generator, but I haven't connected it up yet because it's going to be such a high impedance output. I might wait till I get some op amps. And also, the 4 front buttons, I've also selected them for the SBI programmer, just in case I need to connect it up quite well, be a lot more easier than usual. This is it
finally finished. Alright, just prop that up so you can see it. And as usual, because it's using resistors, it's disconnected, it just floats high. But shorting out using the probe compensation, it's okay. And put this flat battery on it. 1.2 volts, that's not bad. Also, I could try and change it to a different scale. 4 volts, and I've got to flip that switch. Oh, that's annoying. So, short it out. That looked like zero to me. Put it on here. 1.2 volts. That's not bad, not bad. Let's give channel 3 a go. Click, click, channel 3, yeah, you see it flips. It does a quick flip just to tell you what channel you're on. Let's go back to channel 3. Oh, it's so fiddly, I wish I had buttons. Isn't bad. And of course, on the front, I've got about 5 volts. It kind of varies, it's a quarter of a volt below USB, or if I flip it to battery power, it's exactly 5 volts, and that's always 3 volts out. That's always handy for something else. The resistor tester is not very good at all, unfortunately. I didn't put much effort into it, because I had the 2 great big plates there, so I could just literally get a resistor and just hold it on top. Unfortunately, it just won't solder properly. The contact resistance is ridiculous. So the only kind of testing I can do is by kind of holding it on there to show about 1K. See, I've got another smaller resistor. This is about 130 ohms. Oh, maybe I'll correct it one day. Let's connect some other voltages to it. Okay, I've just got this little power supply built. Fortunately, you have to use that as the voltage. The output voltage on that is reading a bit wrong. I used the wrong kind of variable resistor. It was far too large for trimming. You just breathe on it and it just changes volts. That was too big. Go to the 10 volt range. Come on. Oh, he's jumping around quite a bit. Come on, you can do it. Now, perhaps I use the better range, in fact. Channel 1. That's better, connect it in. That's reading about 9.7 volts and over there, 9.68. That's not bad. I might do a little adjustment. Down to about 1.25. Oh, and I'm in on the 10 volt range. Okay. Yeah. 9.8. That's not bad. Let's actually try a different scale. Alright. Try the other 30 volts. change the display. 1.7, so now I could put, whack it up. About 15.12. Yeah, 15.12. Yeah, seems to be working right. And perhaps I'll show you, it can actually do mice as well. Although there is a sort of a common ground earth, I'm not too bothered. I flip that around temporarily. I've also got the negative there and also showing minus 15. However, the negative rail isn't that great, but I don't care. At least ground and positive volts are pretty accurate. Right, now I'll just try and shoving in a different signal. If I can connect all this up. Made this little box to run off an old laptop power supply. Right, let's power you up. The voltage multiplier blew in that thing. Oh, the flashing light just means the batteries are out. It's on, isn't it? Yeah. Right, so here we go. Connect up. Minus. Oh, where's the tip gone? Oh well. Come on. What are you doing? You're gonna fit again. Oh well. Right. Connect you up there. Connect you up there. That sine wave out. But I think last time I set it was about 50 hertz. And you need adjusting. Come on. That's it. You're getting there. You can do it. Finally, you're warmed up. Oh, the triggering's pretty bad. Ah, there you go. Let's knock you down. Right, as you probably notice that this is set to DC and it's jumping around like crazy. Now, I actually like that because it's only sampling 64 samples. So that I can see that it isn't a standard DC, it's just something's wrong with that signal. So at least it's quite obvious it's AC. Flip it to AC, now that's capturing thousands of samples. And that's giving you the average RMS. Well, the negative's a bit off, but it still generally works. So you know, I should be able to shove a DC offset on it. Right, here we go. Click you there. Get rid of you. I'll connect you to there. So there we go. The AC is about now 2.5 ish. The scope showing that as well. Ugh. Well, that was awkward. Cool. I did make a AC-DC coupling input, but due to the low impedance, it's completely useless. So I guess I'll just have to wait till I ever get some cheap or really or free op amps to make it work. Right, I'll switch it into oscilloscope mode. Ground connected. Oh, let's shove it onto DC. Of course, with probe compensation. Okay. When I start it up, dink, you can see on the front. And, well, in 8-bit mode, it's the resolution is not that great. But, oh well, no problems. We'll just stop it and flip it to 10-bit mode. You see, it's actually a lot better. It's giving you a lot more better average. In fact, it's over 9,000 samples. But it looks better when I'm using 8-bit mode, so I'll flip back to that. So it's just capturing the basic, 30 volt range. Yep. I could change the time division, or I could just move it off. In fact, it's capturing a whole load of buffer information. So if I just decrease the buffer size, be able to see the changes better. So drag you across. So sort of see it start scrolling. Oh, by the way, I've made the trigger on the very end. I know it's supposed to be in the center and whatnot, but I prefer it at the very beginning. Make it at the very beginning, it's jittering because it's actually updating the buffer as it's going on screen. So I just relax screen update. So at least it looks a lot more smoother. I could just change the time scale as well. God, I can't even notice that. For the input calibration, I made a whole section here. So for every form of input, had offset, gain and linearity. I mean, for the first one where I just used pure resistors, hey, I did a pretty good job. Except for the 30 volts, which I probably used the most, but me, oh well. And I should have made two kinds of linearity, really, for positive and negative, but it's all right, it is right now. And the more important part is the logger. It will just slowly log those four channels. And just make that change that a bit. So the good thing is I can monitor four over a longer period. Oh, a little bit of a bug there is it keeps switching channels, but that's not a big deal. Okay, log every 2 seconds. Only when there's a great, let's say log every 0.1. Only when there's a difference of 1 volt. Say 1.2, 1.5, 1.9. Oh yeah, it's slowing down, I guess. Point 0.9, 0.1. Right, now it's just going like crazy. You can make a waveform generator mode on this. Square. Sort of chains and a sine wave, triangle, all the standards for waveforms. However, I only really done the GUI mode because I didn't really fully implement the hardware because, you know, do the resistor divider ladder and it's all very high impedance output. So I thought, well, perhaps I'll actually sort of do the resistor ladder once I actually get some op amps. But it still looks pretty nifty. Let's do the sine there. Oh, starting to look jumpy, all right. But I suppose it looks better at a slower time scale. Oh my god, the anti-aliasing, that looks pretty. If I turn the capture back on, I've got a bit more of a bigger waveform now. Oh, that's better. Okay. 8-bit capture, you can see it's sort of scrolling along a bit. Well, you can sort of see the trigger doing its job. Right, I think I'll just stop that. And I could use this to scroll left and right throughout the whole buffer, or I could just use the right mouse to scroll slowly. And also made a little feature, I could just drag that down to there, and it will show you the voltage delta and time down there, I guess, with that between there and there as well. I also did make it enable speed, so if I've got a probe and I was poking around a board, it will just keep streaming, you know, 10.3 volts, 11.5, just every few seconds, because sometimes I do find that handy when I'm staring at a board through a magnifying glass. I don't have to keep looking upwards all the time. Hey, it sort of works, but it's quite embarrassing, so I ain't going to show you.
Finally, here's the code.